Κυρίες και κύριοι, εκλεκτοί προσκεκλημένοι, καλησπέρα σας. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, good evening. Θα θέλαμε να σας ενημερώσουμε ότι υπάρχει ταυτόχρονη μετάφραση στο κανάλι 4 για την αγγλική γλώσσα και στο κανάλι 2 για την ελληνική. We would like to inform you that during tonight's lecture there will be a simultaneous translation. For translation to Greek, you should turn to channel 2 and for English, please turn to channel 4. Σας ενημερώνουμε ότι σε παρακείμενη αίθουσα προβάλλεται απευθείας η διάλεξη για όσους δεν έχουν εξασφαλίσει θέση. Το Πανεπιστήμιο Κύπρου σας καλωσορίζει στην πρώτη ετήσια διάλεξη Υπερίων που διοργανώνεται για πρώτη φορά φέτος με την ευγενή προσφορά της εταιρείας Hyperion Systems Engineering. Ο εισηγητής της πρώτης ετήσιας διάλεξης, κύριος Λόρενς Εβανς, ομότιμος καθηγητής χημικής μηχανικής του Τεχνολογικού Ινστιτούτου Μασαχουσέτης και ιδρυτής της Aspen Technology, θα αναπτύξει το θέμα με τίτλο «Fostering Innovation with an Impact – The MIT Experience in Creating Entrepreneurial Success». Μετά την παρουσίαση του κυρίου Evans, θα ακολουθήσει συζήτηση. Τη συζήτηση θα συνονίσει ο κύριος Σταύρος Πανός, εκτελεστικός αντιπρόεδρος της Hyperion Systems Engineering. Στο σημείο αυτό, καλείται ο πρίτανης του Πανεπιστημίου Κύπρου, καθηγητής Κωνσταντίνος Χριστοφίδης, να προσέλθει στο βήμα για να χαιρετήσει την εκδήλωση. Κύριε πρίτανη.
Καλησπέρα σας. Εξοχότατε πρώην Πρόεδρε της Κυπριακής Δημοκρατίας, κύριε Βουλευτά, κύριε εκπρόσωποι των κοινοβουλευτικών κομμάτων, κύριε Evans, κύριε Πρόεδρε και μέλη του Συμβουλίου, κυρία Πρίτανη του ΤΕΠΑΚ, αγαπητά μέλη της Συγκλήτου, αγαπητές και αγαπητοί συνάδελφοι, διευθύνοντα σύμβουλοι της Hyperion Systems Engineering, αγαπητέ φίλε Σημεών, αγαπητές φοιτήτριες και αγαπητοί φοιτητές, καλησπέρα σας λοιπόν. Με ιδιαίτερη χαρά σας καλωσορίζω στην πρώτη διάλεξη Υπερίων που πραγματοποιείται για να επισφραγίσει την έναρξη της συνεργασίας του Πανεπιστημίου Κύπρου με την εταιρεία Hyperion Systems Engineering. Μια σημαντική συνεργασία που περιλαμβάνει επίσης και την θεσμοθέτηση 2 ετήσιων βραβείων ύψους 3.000 ευρώ έκαστο σε αριστούχους φοιτητές της Σχολής Θετικών και Εφαρμοσμένων Επιστημών και της Πολυτεχνικής Σχολής. Η 20χρονη εμπειρία της Κυπριακής Εταιρείας Υπερίων στην παροχή συμβουλευτικών υπηρεσιών και υπηρεσιών εφαρμογής και υποστήριξης εξελιγμένων συστημάτων μηχανικής την εδραιώνει στο χώρο δραστηριοποίησής της. Η διεθνή της παρουσία και η συνεργασία της με καταξιωμένες εταιρείες αποδεικνύουν την καθιέρωσή της στην συνείδηση των πελατών της ως παροχία καινοτόμων και αποτελεσματικών λύσεων. Στον πυρήνα των αξιών που διέπουν τον οργανισμό βρίσκεται η υπεροχή, η ποιότητα, η καινοτομία, η ανάπτυξη του ανθρώπινου δυναμικού, ο σεβασμός, η υπευθυνότητα και η κερδοφορία. Οι αξίες πάνω στις οποίες οικοδομήθηκε ο οργανισμός φανερώνουν ότι η Υπερίων έχει θέσει ψηλά τον πύχη απόδοσης με στόχο την αριστεία τόσο της ίδιας όσο και των πελατών της. Εκ μέρους της πανεπιστημιακής κοινότητας θέλω να ευχαριστήσω θερμά τον διευθύνοντα σύμβολο και φίλο Δόκτω Σημεών Κασιανίδη, τον εκτελεστικό αντιπρόεδρο κύριο Σταύρο Σπανό και την εταιρεία για την επένδυση στους φοιτητές μας αλλά και την εργοδότησή τους σε θέση πλήρους απασχόλησης. Σε καιρούς δύσκολους είναι ιδιαίτερα σημαντικό οι εταιρείες και επιχειρήσεις να επενδύουν στα παιδιά του Πανεπιστημίου μας, στη νέα γενιά που είναι και το μέλλον του τόπου. Πρόκειται για μια επενδυτική στρατηγική στην έρευνα και στους νέους επιστήμονες που μπορεί να αποδώσει στο μέγιστο, καθώς η επένδυση σε ανθρώπινο δυναμικό είναι η σημαντικότερη για κάθε οργανισμό που θέλει να προοδεύει, να εξελίσσεται και να αναπτύσσεται. Είναι βέβαιο ότι ο διαχρονικός χρυσός μιας χώρας είναι η δημιουργικότητα των ανθρώπων της. Το μέγεθος μιας χώρας δεν εξάρτεται πια από το γεωγραφικό της μέγεθος, ούτε από το μέγεθος του πληθυσμού της. Το μέγεθος μιας χώρας εξαρτάται από το μέγεθος των μυαλών των νέων ανθρώπων της. Επιπρόσθετα, με τη δωρεάν της Hyperion, συνολικού ύψους 10.000 ευρώ, εγκαινιάζεται σήμερα η πρώτη διάλεξη Hyperion. Η διοργάνωση της αιτήσεως αυτής διάλεξης στοχεύει στην επιμόρφωση και την ενημέρωση του κοινού από σημαντικές προσωπικότητες στον χώρο δραστηριοποίησης της Hyperion. Ο μιλητής λοιπόν της απόψινής μας διάλεξης είναι ο κύριος, ο καθηγητής Lawrence Evans, ομότιμος καθηγητής χημικής μηχανικής του Τεχνολογικού Ινστιτούτου Μασαχουσέτης, ο οποίος θα μας μιλήσει για την υπεροχή της καινοτομίας και πώς μέσα από την τέχνη του καινοτομήν διακρίθηκαν και πέτυχαν επιχειρήσεις τις οποίες ίδρυσαν απόφοιτοι του MIT. Κύριε Evans, σας καλωσορίζω στο Πανεπιστήμιο Κύπρου. Professor, welcome you to the University of Cyprus. Βασικός στόχος του ακαδημαϊκού μας ιδρύματος είναι η ουσιαστική του εμπλοκή και συμβολή στην κοινωνική και οικονομική ανάπτυξη του τόπου, μέσα από τη διδασκαλία και την έρευνα. Στοχεύουμε σε ένα υψηλό επίπεδο διδασκαλίας που να οξύνει τα μυαλά των φοιτητών μας και να παράγει δημιουργικούς ανθρώπους. Συνάμα, στοχεύουμε στην παραγωγή πλούσιου ερευνητικού έργου, μέσα από την προσέλκυση κονδυλίων για ερευνητικά προγράμματα που θα ωφελέσουν την χώρα. Σύνθημά μας, οι τρεις περιεκτικές λέξεις: γνώση, έρευνα, καινοτομία. Ταυτόχρονα, αρχίσαμε την εκστρατεία «Ερευνητές για την Κύπρο», όπου προσπαθούμε να σταματήσουμε τη ροή νέων επιστημόνων προς το εξωτερικό, με δεκάδες, ελπίζω σύντομα εκατοντάδες, υποτροφίες που συλλέγουμε από πολλούς επιχειρηματίες και φίλους του Πανεπιστημίου. Τα διπλώματα ευεσιτεχνίας αποτελούν αναμφίβολα μέσα εφαρμογής των ερευνητικών αποτελεσμάτων για εξυπηρέτηση της κοινωνίας, συμβάλλοντας στην περαιτέρω ανάπτυξη της κυπριακής κοινωνίας, στη δημιουργία νέων ευκαιριών απασχόλησης, καθώς και στην ενθάρρυνση της διασύνδεσης των πανεπιστημίων με τη βιομηχανία. Άλλωστε, σε ανακοίνωσή της, η Ευρωπαϊκή Επιτροπή τον Ιανουάριο σημειώνει την ανάγκη εντατικής ενεργοποίησης του επιχειρηματικού δυναμικού της Ευρώπης για να επανέλθει η ανάπτυξη. Στο σχέδιο δράσης υποστήριξης των επιχειρηματιών και αλλαγής της επιχειρηματικής νοοτροπίας στην Ευρώπη, υπογραμμίζεται ο θεμελιώδης ρόλος της εκπαίδευσης προς την κατεύθυνση αυτή. Το σχέδιο δράσης για την επιχειρηματικότητα 2020 αναφέρει, μεταξύ άλλων, ότι η τριτοβάθμια εκπαίδευση στην επιχειρηματικότητα μπορεί να τονώσει τις εταιρείες υψηλής τεχνολογίας και υψηλής ανάπτυξης, υποστηρίζοντας οικοσυστήματα επιχειρήσεων, συνεργασίας και βιομηχανικές συμμαχίες. Η εκπαίδευση, η γνώση, η έρευνα και η καινοτομία είναι η απάντηση στην κρίση. Η γνώση σε συνδυασμό με την κριτική σκέψη, η στοχευμένη έρευνα με στόχο την εξυπηρέτηση του συνόλου της κοινωνίας, η δημιουργικότητα και η καινοτομία αποτελούν τα όπλα μας για επαναφορά της οικονομίας σε τροχιά ανάπτυξης. Και το Πανεπιστήμιο Κύπρου οφείλει, παρά τις δύσκολες συγκυρίες, να εντοπίζει και να αξιοποιεί τις ευκαιρίες προς αυτήν την κατεύθυνση. Σας ευχαριστώ.
Ευχαριστούμε, κύριε Πρίτανη. Καλείται στο βήμα ο Δόκτωρ Σημεών Κασιανίδης, πρόεδρος και διευθύνων σύμβουλος της Hyperion Systems Engineering Limited, για να χαιρετήσει την εκδήλωση. Κύριε Κασιανίδη.
Εκλεκτοί προσκεκλημένοι, αγαπητοί φίλοι, εγώ θα μιλήσω στα αγγλικά προς τιμή του καθηγητή. So, dear friends, it gives me great pleasure in welcoming the MIT Emeritus Professor Lawrence Evans as a speaker in the inaugural annual Hyperion Lecture. The choice of Larry is directly related to us being here today, as he has had an involvement with Hyperion from the very beginning. 1991, when I conceived the idea of forming a company in the area of process systems engineering to commercialize the results of my PhD research, I approached Larry, who had been my undergraduate advisor and who had successfully founded his own company. What followed was a period of mentoring, encouragement, and cooperation. After 18 months, the idea had turned into a validated business plan, and Hyperion was formed. Aspen Tech, his company, became one of the founding partners of Hyperion System Engineering, contributing startup capital. So, in simple words, his belief in innovation, determination in supporting new ideas, and willingness to be there at times directly involved and at times in the background contributed both to the formation of Hyperion, its growth, and is today contributing to our 20 years anniversary celebration. So who is Larry Evans in a few words? Larry is recognized for pioneering development and application of integrated systems for chemical process modeling, simulation, and optimization. He founded Aspen Technology in 1981 and served as its chairman and CEO until 2002. Under his leadership, the company grew from a startup to become the leading provider of software and solutions to the process manufacturing industries. Today, the company's engineering, manufacturing, and supply chain software is virtually a standard in the chemical, petroleum, and pharmaceutical industries worldwide. From 2005 to 2012, Larry Evans served as Chief Executive Officer and co-founder of a new venture, Rive Technology. Rive today is a company commercializing advanced catalyst technology for clean energy applications. He talks to us today as Professor Emeritus of MIT. From 1962 to 1990, he was a professor of chemical engineering at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where he was well known for his work in computer-aided process design and process control. He has received several awards and held a number of positions, and allow me to outline a few. In 1982, the Computing and Systems Technology Division of the American Institute of Chemical Engineers gave Larry its Computing and Chemical Engineering Award. In 1997, Ernst & Young named him Entrepreneur of the Year for High Technology in the New England region. Fortune magazine called him one of the seven U.S. heroes of manufacturing in 1999. That same year, he received the University of Michigan College of Engineering's Alumni Society Merit Award from the Department of Chemical Engineering. In 2001, Evans Larry was elected to the National Academy of Engineering. Chemical Engineering magazine chose him for the 2002 Award for Personal Achievement in Chemical Engineering. In 2003, he was elected to the University of Oklahoma College of Engineering Distinguished Graduate Society, and he received the Engineering Achievement Award from the Engineering Construction Contracting Association. In 2007, he served as president of the American Institute of Chemical Engineers. In 2008, the American Institute of Chemical Engineers named him as one of the 100 chemical engineers of the modern era. More recently, in 2011, he received the Richard Bolt Award for Supporting Industries from the Chemical Heritage Foundation. Closing, I would like to thank Larry for his continuing support and the honor he has made to Hyperion to accept our invitation to be with us this evening. Larry, welcome to the University of Cyprus and the first annual Hyperion Lecture. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Simeon, for that very kind introduction. And thank you also to the University of Cyprus and to the rector for hosting this lecture. It's a real pleasure for me to be here. It's the first time I've been back to Cyprus in 9 years. And so it's good to see what has happened in this period of time. And I would say that you know, it's been the past 9 years has been very challenging for us. There have been tremendous advances in technology and the computing world. I mean, we wouldn't even wouldn't even under, couldn't hardly imagine what the environment was like nine years ago when we didn't have smartphones and the internet was just getting going. We've also been through a very serious world recession in the last 9 years, most recently, and unemployment has gotten pretty high in most places, and I know it's been particularly serious here in Cyprus. But there are a lot of good things in Cyprus that I see. I mean, one thing I see that your presidential campaign is going to be concluding in another week, and you'll be electing a new, welcoming a new government. And I know from the U.S. we suffered through more than a year of really bruising presidential campaigning. But when it was all over, people pretty much forgot about it and began to look to the future. And so I think you'll see the same thing happening here in Cyprus. My topic today is, let me say a few things. First of all, I'm also would like to congratulate Hyperion Systems Engineering in what they've achieved. It's really gratifying to be here and to help them celebrate the 20th anniversary. Well, the topic that Simeon wanted me to speak about was fostering innovation with an impact, and to talk about the MIT experience in creating entrepreneurial success. So I'm going to say first a few words about what that impact actually was, give you some facts and figures on what we've achieved. Then I'm going to talk about what it takes to create a successful company. And then I'm going to give you a few, share a little of my experience in forming Aspen Technology. And then we'll talk about the MIT ecosystem, which has been very instrumental in creating a number of companies, and what lessons this might hold for Cyprus. MIT conducted a study in 2003 of the impact that they've had. And they did this by surveying all 105,000 living alumni. They sent them all a questionnaire and they asked, have you started any companies in your career? And if so, what are the names of them? How many have you done and what are they? And they created a database of all the companies that they have been established by MIT alumni. And the results are pretty amazing. More than 26,000 companies have been created by MIT alumni. And these companies generate $3.3 million people employed with sales of $2 trillion. And if all this economic activity were in the form of a country, it would turn out that the country would be the 11th largest economy in the world. It would be between Canada and Australia. So it's pretty amazing. I mean, it surprised me when I saw these numbers. And these results are conservative too. First of all, they excluded a number of they didn't count a company if the founder was no longer alive, and that left some companies like Intel, for example, and Hewlett-Packard. They were not included in the study. They didn't count them if the company no longer was an independent company, if it had been merged or combined with someone, and so that excluded companies like Digital Equipment Corporation that was merged with Compaq. It excluded Lotus Development, which is part of IBM. They didn't count it if it was founded by faculty or staff who didn't have a degree at MIT, and so that excluded Aspen Technology, the company I founded, because I was never an undergraduate. And they also excluded companies that were based on MIT research, but which there weren't any MIT alumni. So they had a very nice sample by limiting it to companies founded by people who had received a degree from MIT. Simeon was one of the respondents to this survey, and so Hyperion is one of the companies that is listed in this database. In fact, about 1,000 of those 26,000 companies are in fact outside the U.S. But it did include companies no matter how big they were. For example, everything from a two-person architectural consulting firm to giant companies employing tens of thousands of people, they were all included. But it turns out that a few large companies have the largest impact on jobs. In this survey, there were about 540 companies that had more than 1,000 employees each, and that was 2% of the total. But these companies generated 80% of all the revenues that were reported and 70% of all the employees, of all the jobs. So what this really says is that starting a number of companies is important, but the size really matters. And these companies have to grow to become big companies to really make a huge impact. And I think this will be important for us to keep in mind. The MIT companies had an extraordinary impact on the Massachusetts economy, the state in which MIT is located, in that 27% of all those companies are based in Massachusetts. And they have about about a million jobs and $164 billion in annual revenues. And this represents about 25% of the Massachusetts economy. So if it weren't for these MIT-formed companies, the Massachusetts economy would be significantly smaller. And it turns out, so the question arises, what determines where a company is based? And as part of this study, they also surveyed the founders to find out what were the major factors that influenced where they located the company. And not surprisingly, the major factor of where the founders lived was the biggest factor as to where they were at the time. So the point being, if it weren't for MIT, these people would never have been in Massachusetts and the companies would never have been formed. So it has a huge impact. That's why it's also very important, I think, as we look at fostering innovation, we find ways to create companies in Cyprus, because that will, if the activities that take place in Cyprus will lead to jobs in Cyprus. Now let me talk about what it takes to create a company. And you have to start with an idea. Somebody has an idea of how they can bring value to some customers. And these customers might be individuals, in which case it would be for consumers, or they could be companies, other companies, and government organizations. Once you have an idea, though, the next step is to create a plan, a business plan. That's just a plan for translating the idea into a company. And then once you have the plan, of course, you have to execute the plan. And then finally, once you have a company up and running and profitable, then it needs to grow. So I'm going to talk a little bit about each one of these steps in a little bit more detail. Okay, let's start with the idea. Ideas might be driven either from technology or they might be driven by a market need. Both ways work. For example, if you look at Apple Computer, they were based on a technology, basically wireless communication, and they created the smartphone. If you look at Google, they were also based on, say, the internet. There was definitely technology driven. But if we look, some companies are driven instead by a market, by seeing a market opportunity. Here we look at, say, Starbucks, coffee isn't really that much of a technology, but serving it in a nice environment and charging a lot of money for it is a new idea, and that was successful. Bottled water is another example. Whoever dreamed that people would pay money for a bottle of water, but sure enough, it served a real market need. The important thing to note, though, is ideas aren't created in a vacuum. You really need exposure to a network of people and ideas and to get aware of the new technologies. And that will also become important when we talk about about what we can do in Cyprus. You need to be exposed to customers who have problems, otherwise you'll never know what problems that you could be addressing. Then when you get to the business plan, that's sort of the key thing that defines a business. You often use it to go out and raise financing. But the business plan is really just a step-by-step description of how you're going to translate this idea into a business. You know, what resources are you going to need in terms of capital, in terms of people that you need to recruit? You need to design the business model. That is really how you're going to get paid for what you do. You know, how are you going to be able to collect money from customers, and how are you going to price things and charge them? And then there may be some technical problems that still need to be solved to demonstrate proof of concept. And if they are, you have to have a plan for how you're going to overcome those technical plans. So the business plan is really the guts of a new venture. Once you have the plan in mind, then the next step is to execute on that plan, to just do the steps that you laid out and that said you were going to do. And here's where you form the company legally, you secure funding, the financing that you will need, you recruit the key people, and you complete any proof of technology that needs to be done. You attract your first customers and you prove that the business model works. So this is the fun part of a business. This is when you find space and you get to see a sign up on the wall for your company, the name of the company, and you get to print your business cards with the name of the company, and you realize that you really have created an entity. But once the company is profitable, then it has to grow. And you're going to have to scale every aspect of the company for growth to make it larger. Everything from human resources to sales to development, from all aspects of the company, you have to scale them up. And you have to implement the systems, of course, that support growth, accounting, management, all of these things, and defend the company against competition. So what kind of a person can really do all these things? And it turns out that in many cases, one person really doesn't provide the complete skill set that you need. Most successful companies have a combination of a technical visionary, somebody who really understands the technology, and a skilled business leader who's had some business experience and knows how to sort of get things done and translate these ideas into a real company. In some cases, those are both the same person. In Aspen Tech's case, the company I founded, I served both of those roles. I was a technical visionary, but then I had to learn on the job many of the skills, the business skills, that you need to know. If you look at a couple of well-known examples, I mean, Apple Computer is by far the best example of a technical visionary and a business leader. In the early days, Steve Jobs was a technical leader. He tried to be the CEO at that time and run the company, but he wasn't suited to it. And they wound up bringing somebody in, and eventually he left the company. But then, a number of years later, he came back as CEO and proved to be having gotten some experience in some other activities, and now he's been hailed as probably the greatest CEO in almost the last century. So that's a great example. Another good example is Google. Google was founded by Larry Page and Sergey Brin, who had this idea for a search capability. But they knew enough to recruit a CEO to come in and join them and run the company. But now, after all these years, then Larry Page feels he has the experience and he's now been promoted to be CEO. So the point I'm making is you really need a combination of technical visionary and business experience. And that's going to be one of the important things that you need to figure out a way to provide. Now let me say a few words about Aspen Technology. When I arrived at MIT in 1962, Boston was the center of entrepreneurial activity. It was before Silicon Valley had been formed. In fact, there was a Route 128 that encircled Boston. And it was just, there were probably several dozen companies formed out on that Route 128. These were electronics companies in 1962, mostly. They were providing doing a lot of defense contracting, for example. This was during the era of the Cold War. The companies like Digital Equipment, Raytheon, Arthur D. Little, BBNN were formed out there. And these companies had been funded by, three companies had been actually formed by the chemical engineering faculty members when I got there. The chairman of the department, Professor Gilliland, had founded Ionics, which was doing a water desalination by an electrochemical process. There were two other companies involving, were doing membrane separation processes. So it was a lot of entrepreneurial activity going on when I arrived. The MIT Alumni Association started giving workshops, and I remember they gave their first one in October of 1969, and it was titled Starting and Building Your Own Company. It was the first one they had given. They expected about 30 people to show up, and they had 300 people. It was oversubscribed, and I was one of those 300 people in the audience, and it was a very exciting time to be there and see these examples. Now, to understand Aspen a little bit in the technology, you need to kind of roll the clock back to the 1960s and understand what things were like then. Mainframes were the computing environment of the time. I imagine there are even a few people in this room who can remember that era of computing. You prepared your input data for the computer, a deck of cards, of IBM cards. You took it to the computing center. You gave them the deck of cards, and then they kept it overnight. And the next morning, you got back a printout with the answers. So that was mainframe computing. And all the major chemical petroleum companies, they had developed systems for computer modeling and simulation. I mean, Monsanto had their Flotran system, Shell had Specs, and Exxon had their COPE system. Every major company had a proprietary system that was really, it ran on the mainframe, and it was used by just a few experts, if it was hardly used at all. But meanwhile, MIT was a hotbed of activity in computer-aided problem solving, and they were developing time sharing at MIT to use the computer interactively, more like we do today. And there was a project there for computer-aided mechanical engineering, computer-aided civil engineering, there was computer-aided electrical engineering, but there wasn't chemical engineering. And so I said, why not chemical engineering? And then in 1973, the first energy crisis occurred, and we thought, the U.S. thought it was going to have to build hundreds of synthetic fuel plants to convert coal to gasoline. And I told myself, well, they're going to need a lot better computing tools to be able to do this, so this was my opportunity. So the idea was then create the Aspen Project at MIT, which took place from 1976 to 81. The idea was to create a new system. We called it Aspen, for Advanced System for Process Engineering. And it would be a software system that would be shared by many computers. So instead of having these proprietary systems, there would be one system with next generation technology. It would be flexible, so it could handle solids like coal. And it would use the new computing technology. It would be much easier to use. And my plan was to then go to the Department of Energy, which had just been formed, get them to fund it at some $5 million. And we were able to do that. We recruited staff on loan from industry to come to MIT and work on the project. We actually spent, of the $5 million we raised, we spent $500,000 to purchase the Flotrans system. That was what the system Monsanto had developed. It was, they kept it proprietary, and, but for $500,000 they agreed to make the source code, let us make the source code available and use it to build the Aspen software. So we had, to day one, we had something that worked and had credibility. And so we executed the project, we delivered the code to the Department of Energy in 1981, and they were going to make it available free to the public, to anyone who wanted to get it. But we knew that any software system that was not continually supported and maintained would not be used. And so the idea in 1981, some of the founders of Aspen, at the Aspen Project, decided to form a new software, a private company, to develop a commercial version of the Aspen software. So our plan was to get a non-exclusive license from MIT, which we did, to raise financing from venture capital firms, to rent space and computer time from MIT, and to recruit the founding staff from the Aspen Project. And as a result, in 1981, we founded Aspen Tech as an independent company. But there was one glitch in the whole plan. We were not able to raise venture capital. They simply didn't want to invest in an inexperienced CEO, namely me, and they didn't want to also invest in software. That software was a new concept. You know, this was the era of electronics. There were only a couple of successful software companies. People didn't even think of that as being a company. So we raised $2 million, which is a lot of money at the time, from friends and family. The founders all mortgaged our houses and raised money, and we got a few private wealthy individuals to put some money up. And one way or another, we raised the money, and we were able to begin offering then the commercial version of Aspen Plus on a subscription basis. We used a little different business model where they paid so much, and then for, they paid $50,000 a year, in fact, and they got continually updates and enhancements to the software. They got support, they got new releases. And so we continued to develop and enhance the software. And if you look at a few of the milestones along the way, in 1983, we issued our first commercial version of Aspen called Aspen Plus. Then, finally, in 1986, we attracted a $2 million investment in venture capital from Advent International. In 1990, we were ready to go public. We thought we were, at least. And so on the very day that we were having the organizational meeting with the investment bankers and the lawyers and all, Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait. And I can remember that day very well. And the window for IPOs closed. They were no longer, the financial markets were down, it was all in turmoil, and so we had to postpone, which was actually a wonderful thing because we weren't ready to be a public company at that time anyway. We were too small. So our venture capital investors put some more money in. We wound up acquiring a company in the UK called Process Technology that did dynamic simulation, which complemented our steady state simulation. And finally, in 1994, we were able to go public, had a very successful public offering, and then over the next 8 years, we acquired more than 20 best-in-class companies as part of a strategy to go from, to use the same tools that the engineers use on their desktop to design plants, to use these to run and optimize plants. And finally, in 2002, as Simeon said, I stepped down as CEO. Today, Aspen Tech is the largest supplier of technical software to the chemical and petroleum industry. Their company is doing about a $300 million revenue rate, and it was sort of a darling of the stock market these most recent days. It's has a market capitalization of almost $3 billion. So Aspen Tech has been successful, stays on as an independent company. Meanwhile, as Simeon said, I left, stepped down as CEO, and got involved with another startup company doing something completely different, not software, doing the development of a refinery catalyst for cat cracking. but we don't have time to talk about that. It's still in the early stages anyway. This shows, I dug out a graph that showed the growth in employees of Aspen Tech. And if you'll notice, it goes from 92 to 97, 15 years. But you'll notice it wasn't until about 96 that we hit 1,000 employees. It took us about 12 years to get up to 1,000 employees. And that happened because we had gone public by that time and did some acquisitions. So I think this is an explanation. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about the ecosystem at MIT. What is done there to encourage formation of companies? And if you look in the early days, MIT has always had close ties with industry and been a place that encouraged doing things, practical things. When it was founded in 1981, its motto was Mens et Manus, which is a Latin for mind and hand. And it means the whole idea was to value learning in the laboratory as much as learning in the classroom, and to value creating practical, useful things as much as creating new knowledge or new intellectual contributions. So the faculty were encouraged to consult with industry, to form companies. In fact, for promotion at MIT, if you've been successful as a consultant and done something related to industry, that's a plus. In many universities, that's not the case, but that's always been the case at MIT. The first venture capital firm was founded around Boston. It was American Research and Development, or ARD. It was formed in 1946 by George Doriot and Carl Compton. Doriot had been dean of the Harvard Business School. Compton had been president of MIT. And they had a lot of early successes. They invested in Ionics that I just mentioned, and Digital Equipment Corporation was one of their early investments, which was very, very successful for them. And out of that, a number of other venture capital firms got established. The whole idea, so Doriot really, with ARD, invented the concept of venture capital. And so there was a lot of venture capital in Boston. It's always been a center of that. But MIT has also taken practical initiatives to support entrepreneurship. And in 1960, the first course was given. It was called New Enterprises. It was offered in the management school in 1960. In 1969, the MIT alumni started offering these, providing these weekend workshops that I mentioned, the one that I attended. In 1978, the MIT Enterprise Forum was established, and now there are 25 chapters of this. It's an independent organization located in companies or cities around the world. They have typically once a month they would meet and have a program that consisted of a couple of young companies presenting their business plan to a panel of venture capitalists, and then they would get a critique on their business plan. So the individuals got some good advice, and the audience got an education in what it means to start a company. So those were wonderful events. I went to many of them myself, and as I said, now it's grown to 24 cities around the world. The licensing office at MIT was established in 1986 to encourage licensing MIT-developed technology to private companies. And then in 1990, the first business plan competition was held. It was called a 10K plan because it awarded a prize to the best business plan, and it was $10,000. And that has now grown to the 50K, and now it's a 100K business plan. Maybe it'll go even higher in terms of the award. Now, there are business plan competitions in many places, including here in Cyprus. And there are also many other specialized business plan competitions, like one for energy, one for women-founded firms. So it's proved to be a good way to encourage interest in entrepreneurship. In 1996, the MIT Entrepreneurship Center was founded, and they had their first full-time director, a person named Ken Morse. Ken had actually been one of the early people at Aspen Tech. In fact, he led development of our sales and marketing capability in Europe and then later in Asia. So so he was a big factor in getting the Entrepreneurship Center going at MIT. In 2000, they established a venture mentoring program so that anybody who has an idea for a company at MIT can be paired with a successful entrepreneur who will provide advice and help them in doing their hand-holding. In 2002, the MIT Center for Technology Innovation was established. It's called the Deshpande Center because Desh Deshpande, who's a wealthy alumnus at MIT, funded it with about $80 million. And the center provides funding to research projects at the university to enable professors to take their research ideas and convert them to proof of concept, take them to the stage where they can raise venture capital. And in 2006, the management school established an entrepreneurship track, and they now about a quarter, 25% of the MBA students select this track. It's for people who are interested in entrepreneurial life. And so, if you look at these elements of the ecosystem, they tend to support the basic activities of idea flow, of providing training, of providing mentoring, and of providing capital. Well, let me then finally, the last topic I want to just say, what can we say, are there any lessons from Cyprus that can be learned from the MIT experience? I mean, you certainly wouldn't expect a country or a city, a country of 750,000 people to be able to match sort of what MIT can do, and that's not the goal. But the goal is something on a similar scale. Can we achieve a meaningful contribution here in Cyprus? And I think, first of all, you need to look at a lot of the strengths that you have in Cyprus. I think a major advantage is the people. I think the strong Greek culture in Cyprus is a big asset. It's always valued education, it values ideas, values the work ethic. It's very open to new ideas. That is a very important factor. The heritage of trading, commerce, means you also have people who are interested in being successful, making ventures that make commercial success, and you have an educated workforce, not to speak of the fact that the very strategic location of the island itself, you know, as sort of the crossroads of the world, is I think an important asset. I think the need to create jobs, particularly now, provides a strong incentive. The high unemployment rate provides an incentive to create, to put more focus on jobs. Hopefully that can be translated into funding and activities. And I think encouraging innovation and the creation of new ventures can contribute to the economy. I think realistically, one of the things that we need to be aware of, it will take time to produce meaningful results. You know, you could because it takes time to grow companies from a startup to become a successful company. That's just a fact of life. You'll get some results within a decade, and substantial results, I think, will take longer. So you have to think of it, it's not a quick fix, but it's an investment in the future. And that's not, and I think we don't want to underestimate the psychological impact. When people see that companies are being created and new products are being developed and there's activity, it gives them a lot of hope for the future of the company, even out of proportion, I think, to the actual dollar impact of the jobs they perform. The fact that the country is investing and that's the future of the country, I think, is an important thing. It's very important in the U.S. in terms of the self-image of being able to get things done and being able to do things. And I think it would be true here as well. We do need, you will need to address some challenges. There are challenges of being a small country. Because, remember, these ideas don't come in a vacuum. They come from networking, from talking to people. And when you have sort of a closed door, a small population, you need to find ways to network internationally, network with other places, network with, you know, places like MIT. Fortunately, the timing is great because we have the internet, we have a global communications, but I think we have to be innovative here in Cyprus and take advantage of that. And need to look also for international collaborators. There'll be a lot of companies that would want to collaborate and need somebody here. So my recommendations are, first of all, you already have, as the rector mentioned, an entrepreneurial ecosystem under development here in Cyprus. You have business plan competitions, you have government funding of applied research, you have educational courses at universities, and probably a number of other things that I'm not totally aware of. But there is a nucleus here to begin to build on. And I think so this needs to be encouraged and strengthened. That would be my recommendation. I think one of the first things to do is build up this venture mentoring capability. You may already have that to some extent, but I consider forming a branch of the MIT Enterprise Forum. They have chapters in 24 cities around the world. Why not have a 25th chapter here? And that would let you sort of tap into that whole group. And I think you should get established entrepreneurs in Cyprus in some organized way to be willing to serve as mentors to new startup companies. Simeon mentioned very kindly that I helped them as a mentor in the early days with Hyperion. I think that is not to be underestimated. I had a mentor that I went to at Aspen Tech on a regular basis, and it was invaluable. And then you need to substantially increase the venture capital resources that are available, because these companies, if you have ideas and they start to develop, they're going to need some capital. And you know, some of the ideas I had, just sort of off the top of my head, were providing some incentives for European Union venture firms to be more active in Cyprus, to maybe establish offices here. You might want to encourage the local angel investments from wealthy individuals to get some organized activity underway. Maybe some of it already does exist, but I think those are good things to do. You might even consider establishing a government venture capital firm to co-invest with private investors. That was one thing that we'd had in Aspen Tech. When we were formed and I couldn't attract any venture capital investors, there was a state organization called the Massachusetts Technology Development Corporation. And they weren't allowed to invest independently, but if they had somebody else investing, they could co-invest with them. And that helped a lot. And we had one particularly wealthy individual who invested in Aspen Tech at that starting time, and Mass Technology Development also invested. That sort of model might be useful here. The one thing you have to be careful of, though, you don't want politicians making venture capital decisions, you know, because first of all, the companies will not be successful. They'll be embarrassed politically, and that's happened in the U.S., of course, when Obama supported a company called Solyndra, which was a solar energy company that then went bust, and there have been lots of other bad examples of that. And then finally, some things that I think can be a catalyst to make things go faster is taking advantage of the discovery of gas and hopefully oil in the Levant to create new ventures. And I think there'll be opportunities to provide support of exploration and production there, partnering with international firms and maybe investing in university research. I mean, I know you're establishing departments and capabilities here. Maybe you do more focused in university research on problems that would be applicable to production of oil and gas. And then finally, I think you might want to look at the professional services area as a particularly attractive area. You know, recently PwC created a study, some of you may be familiar with it. It was titled Driving Jobs and Growth in Cyprus Through Professional Services. And their recommendation was to have more professional services firms focus on that activity. The advantage is a services firm requires less capital to get started. That's one advantage. Second, they produce the most number of jobs per unit of revenue of pretty much any business, much more than manufacturing. Manufacturing produces money and profits, but not as many jobs as a services firm. And then finally, they can grow fast. They're only limited by how fast they can attract customers and how fast they can hire good people. So I think if you wanted to look for a couple of things that might have a quicker fix, I think these are areas that I would suggest. So with that, I'll say thank you for your attention.
Well, okay. You have to sit here to see how many people are in the room. Okay, well, I guess, first of all, on behalf of everyone in the room, and the next room with the video link, thank you very much, Larry, for the delivery of your lecture. The floor goes to the audience now, and we open up for questions. Any questions, please?
Or comments or suggestions that any of you might have, I think, are also welcome.
Please use the microphone there in order to, for the translators to.
I found very interesting your presentation. What I'm interested in is to network with your company. I'm interested in IT and finding and creating new software engineering. I would love to work with Americans.
Okay. Is there a question there?
How can I do that?
That's a good question.
Well, what's the area of your software? What area are you talking about?
A friend of mine that I have, he explained that Microsoft, I asked Mr. Mark, a representative of the Microsoft company, if there's a way that you can make your software more simpler. And some friend of mine explained me that they don't do it simpler because it's not all the benefit.
Okay, well, that's a good point, but can I please ask you to take it on with Larry later on in the reception?
Okay.
We will have opportunity, as many of us, to talk with Larry. Yes, please.
Yes, my name is Alexandros Karalambidis from the Cyprus University of Technology. Thank you very much for your talk. It was very interesting. And I'm starting my startup from university as well. And is there a danger of overexpanding too soon or trying to do too much too soon? From your experience, what can you advise us? Thank you.
I would say, yes, there is a danger of doing that. And at Aspen Tech, one of the early employees we hired was a person from Harvard who had gotten his MBA. And as a professor, I had lots of ideas, and so I had two or three different initiatives that we were going to get going. And he took me aside and said, look, you really have to focus all your effort. You can't spread yourself too thin. You don't have nearly enough resources to do all these. You have to pick one of these areas and focus on it, and then be successful. Then you can apply the others. So I think it's really the idea of focus just can't be overestimated here.
I have a question. I was wondering, how crucial do you think is the to the success of the MIT entrepreneurial ecosystem and all that success stories, all those success stories in Massachusetts. How critical to that success was the availability of a very mature, I have to admit, US patent system? I mean, you have a mature system in the States where an idea can get recorded, patented, and protected. And the question is, would that influence make easier or difficult attracting capital?
Well, it's important that your idea be be defended from competition. In our case, in Aspen's case, with software, when we formed Aspen Tech, you couldn't patent software, and so most people depended on the fact that for software, simply getting out ahead, being innovative, developing a market, and just having a head start. But certainly in my new company, the new company I'm involved in, which is in commercializing a catalyst for petroleum refining, then it's very important to be able to patent this technology. So it is important to be able to patent it.
Yes, please. And identify yourself, Christopher.
I am Christopher Scaralambu. Sorry. I am from Frederick University. Something cool. Okay.
Sometimes, even if you have a good idea and there is a proof of concept.
From the microphone. Sorry. Okay. Sometimes, even if you have a good idea and you more or less proven it, companies don't trust you easily if you are a startup, especially if you mentioned oil and gas and these industries. It's very difficult to get the trust for them to invest and take a risk in you. Do you think this is an issue, and how can it be addressed?
Well, yes, it is an issue. I mean, you need to be credible to attract investors from somebody else, from someone who put their money in your venture. They want to be comfortable that they will hopefully get it back someday with a return on that investment. And so in the early stages, they're depending a lot on the people. So I think you want to focus a lot on your own skill set. You have to convince them that you're likely to be able to generate some results. Another possibility, though, another good idea I think here is maybe forming an advisory committee. For example, if you have a field, if your field is oil and gas, and you can get a couple of people who are experts, maybe internationally known, and they would agree to be an advisor. Then that gives you a lot more credibility and contacts. That's an idea that we did with this new company I'm forming up. I don't know very much about catalyst, petroleum catalyst, so I got some experts that I did know that knew the industry, and they agreed to be advisors. And this was enormously beneficial in providing some credibility. And you know what, that's just occurred to me thinking of it here with your question. That's something you could do in Cyprus, because you can be an advisor and provide advice with telecommunications, with the internet. You don't have to be physically present to do that all the time.
Yes.
Yes, thank you, Stavros. Now, following up from what... Okay, it's a very interesting technology. So I'm Michael Loizidis. I'm an environmental engineer working for Isotech Limited, research and consultancy firm. Now, Stavros started to say something, and I wanted to follow up on this. what we feel in Cyprus, that the moment that we start our own business, we fall in a rough terrain, so all the infrastructure goes against us in Cyprus. So this is something that I wanted you to tell us if you had the same problems. I mean, to feel that all the licensing system, all the things you have to start from the beginning, you had no assistance from everywhere. Actually, this is what I'm saying. It's not only assistance, is obstacles. The second thing that I wanted to ask you is going abroad. You said that networking internationally. You come from US, so it's an influential country around the world. Did you have governmental support in evolving internationally? Did you have any assistance, let's say, from your embassies, from whatever you can tell us?
That we did have assistance in some cases, particularly in China, where it was helpful to, but they didn't really provide a great assistance. What was really most valuable to us was, I mentioned this person, Ken Morse, who was led our sales activities, and then he subsequently was the founding director of the MIT Entrepreneurship Center. But Ken knew how to do business internationally. He had done business internationally, so that he'd spent 5 years in China himself. He had also been very active, been in Europe a lot. And you might say, Aspen Tech, we had to crack the big German chemical companies to make them customers of ours. And the German chemical companies, they're really really believe in technical excellence, and they are a kind of a closed group of people. And but he found a way to to get one company to be a reference for the other company, and to basically be successful. So I guess the lesson to be learned there is, you need someone who has had experience in working internationally, and in terms of then the government working being a hindrance or a help, I think there's where mentoring would be very useful. I mean, if you had some successful entrepreneurs in Cyprus, and maybe Simeon is the one to talk to about that. If you'd had some successful entrepreneurs in Cyprus who had overcome these difficulties, they can give you some advice. For example, patenting, I think if you just, it seems to me, you don't have to patent things, and if you don't like the system in Cyprus, you can patent your ideas in the United States or in other countries, and the important thing is to have it patented in the areas where it's going to be sold and going to be used. So that would be actually an advantage from Cyprus, because probably most of the usage won't be in Cyprus. It's not big enough, but you could protect it in those other countries. I don't know if that's a good answer, but it's what I would do.
I think we have time for another. Yes, please.
I think it works now. Thank you for a very interesting lecture. I wanted to ask exactly the opposite question from what Michalis was asking. I'm George Kazamias, by the way, from the University of Cyprus. Throughout your work with your company, did you ever have any sort of direct interference from either the government or the investors? And I'm not talking about changes in the legislation or anything like that. I'm talking about somebody from government calling you to ask you something specific that did not have to do with asking them to develop something for them.
I would say no, we didn't have too much hindrance. In fact, we had help. I mentioned this Mass Technology Development Corporation that co-invested with some independent investors early, and so that was helpful. I remember the Aspen project at MIT, that was before the company was founded. We were developing a next generation software system, but it turns out, that there were a couple of systems commercial companies that offered software, and they were just absolutely outraged when they saw that MIT, that we were developing a system that would be publicly available, free of charge, and would compete with their software. So they complained vigorously to the Department of Energy, why are you funding this? You don't need it. We've already got this. I'm
they were very shocked, and so we had to go down. I had to go down and meet with the people at the Department of Energy, and the two of us had to craft a reply back to the congressman from the state where that these other firms were located. So I think that this usually has not been a hindrance, but usually you can co-opt the government people to put them on your side. That's my belief.
Okay, well, yeah.
Yes, if I can have a follow-up question. Your technology, your company started with the $5 million from the Department of Energy, which was governmental money, and then you could go on with the private and expand after that. Do you believe that in Cyprus, with the current economic crisis and with lack of governmental funds, is it possible just with private money to go from research to company and forward?
Well, it's possible. I mean, to the extent that you have to develop, you have to take the idea and you have to somehow get it to proof of concept. Some people can do that depending on the technology. If it's software, some people nowadays can do that all by themselves, just one person can do it if a certain software application. For something like Aspen, chemical engineering, it was a much bigger thing and it didn't exist. So I think, it certainly is possible to do things without government support of the research. To the extent that you can build on research, are you talking about research that would be used at the university, developed originally at the university?
No, it was a general question because you have ideas, you have basic research, but how do you can you make them into a business without the initial governmental support?
It depends on the, obviously depends on the example and generally somebody's got to fund the research. If it requires laboratory equipment, if it requires things like that, someone's got to pay for it. So you probably do need it.
Last question. Yes, please.
Hi, thank you, Dr. Evans. My question is, following up on what I heard you respond to the various previous questions, is it seems to, and from what you said, it seems to me that there was a kind of a parallel evolution. You know, MIT is a hub. A lot of ideas come there. And it also, from your lecture, kind of comes out that there was an evolution of a mindset evolution happening because of all these ideas, mindset evolution of how do we use software, how do we share software, et cetera, and then how do we fund development. And I think this is kind of like what happens in a beginning, is like a need for like a critical mass of people who are willing to develop new ways of thinking and build models around it. And I was wondering if you could share how your experience was a little bit in trying to change mindsets and the challenges there, because a lot of us entrepreneurs have to actually influence others.
Right. Certainly changing the mindset of a large number of people is something that is it's hard to do. It takes time, and so naturally you can't. You have to live. I think you have to live with the environment that you've got. So you start and you say, I'm not going to be able to change the environment that much, that fast. And so we have to live with it. But once you know you have to live with it, then you can figure out ways around it. You can figure out ways to get what you want done. And then meanwhile, look at some of these initiatives that are underway already in Cyprus to build an entrepreneurial ecosystem. Look at those to maybe have a long-range impact. But in the short run, if you want to create a company or do something, you kind of need to figure out, you kind of need to understand, okay, here's my idea. A fixed constraint is we're in Cyprus, we have the current funding situation. Now with these constraints, what can we do to build it? And just figure a way to work around the ideas if you want to be successful. Life is too short to wait for all the mindsets to change. And so.
Reality. Okay. Mike, be short.
Thank you for your presentation.
Can you hear him? No. Doesn't help in the short thing.
Maybe we can hear him anyway.
Yeah.
It's a common observation in Cyprus that a lot of the time, for a Cypriot to be truly innovative as a person, he has to leave this island. And it's a common observation that in many parts of the world, you find we have professors at the top universities, we have academics, we have doctors, we have engineers that have achieved fantastic things outside of Cyprus. And I think that has a lot to do, a lot of the times, with our culture in Cyprus. We're not a very innovative race, but I believe we're better at executing ideas rather than innovating new ideas. You said that MIT, you did that study about MIT and the success of how many people founded companies, etc., graduates of MIT. I'm wondering, did you go one step back and see what exposure these people had at school, elementary and high school? Because I believe at university it's too late. I mean, I think these people had ideas from a younger age. And I'm wondering if anything has been done in schools, or you have any ideas of how to foster these kind of things at a younger age rather than at university level.
Well, I think I don't personally have any experience there, but I do know that people, you know, that they are trying and younger to get younger people thinking in an entrepreneurial sense.
I mean in America, you push this idea of the American dream, kids.
Yes.
Kids that are 8, 9, 10 want to be millionaires.
Right.
They want to have a public company, etc. In Cyprus, you want to be government employees.
Or yeah. Yeah.
So that's the way it works.
Until last month, that is.
Yeah. I think that's a good question. I think you need to maybe address the answer question to Simeon or.
Okay. It's over a drink.
Yes.
All right. So, Larry, sincere thanks for everyone. It's been an honor and a pleasure. Thank you once again, and thank you on behalf of Hyperion Systems Engineering for opening up this Hyperion Lecture, which we hope will become a tradition. We have to think hard who's going to be the second speaker. Mm-hmm. You
know? So, okay, thanks.
Reception. Before you go.
Κυρίες και κύριοι, σας ενημερώνουμε ότι την 3η 12 Φεβρουαρίου στις 6 ο πρόεδρος του Ινστιτούτου Επιστήμης Weizmann στο Ισραήλ, καθηγητής Daniel Zeichman, θα δώσει διάλεξη στον ίδιο χώρο με θέμα το ατέλειωτο ταξίδι προς την Αριστεία και είστε όλοι ευπρόσδεκτοι. Σας ευχαριστούμε πολύ που μας τιμήσατε με την παρουσία σας και σας προσκαλούμε στη δεξίωση που ακολουθεί στο ισόγειο, στο εσωτερικό αίθριο. Καλή σας νύχτα.